Chapter 11, Case File, SIO1, Chapter, Hero, Hope, Case Closed. DSI Office, Sing, Tong Tai, and Ajima, you're preparing the questionnaire to interrogate Narong and Vit, the two best friends from the Forensic Science Division. Now, the team's major problem was material evidence, which they didn't have. Sing let out a sigh as he looked through the glass and observed Narong's behavior. From the moment that Narong had been brought here, he remained still and silent, contrary to those eyes shining bright. That self-assured manner caused Sing to scrutinize that he might have already murdered Songyeos, which meant he had already completed his mission. "We can't find Songyeos. Not sure if he's already been killed," Hajima said, full of concern. "He called the attorney. It showed he was sure that he could get away with it," Tong Tai spoke.
"Did you have someone to search his house?"
"I did. If there is anything, they will report us back," Hajima said to her brother. Sing sunk into his contemplative state. How could he manage to sit back and relax like that?
"When did Narong's sister die?"
5 years ago," answered Tong Tai.
"Has he ever taken a leave from work to attend his sister's funeral?"
Tong Tai paused briefly and hurriedly tapped the keyboard for his information. "He took a 3-day leave." 3 days for arranging a funeral ceremony? Sing was instantly nervous that his hands shook. "What's wrong, Sing?" Hajima laid her hand on her little brother's shoulder in worry. Sing swallowed his saliva hard to his throat.
"Tell PI's team to search his house. Now!"
"Our men were there at both his suburb house and his apartment." After hearing this, Sing instantly dashed to grab a phone at the corner of the room and pressed call to the crime scene investigation team, learning that there was no progress from their side. Sing spoke back to Ajima.
"Not at his house. The crime scene is not at his house."
Ajima flinched. Once she regained her wits, she darted out of the room and pulled everyone in the office at the same time. Coincidentally, Paya was striding toward her. Ajima commanded Paya to navigate to the crime scene as soon as possible before it was destroyed. Paya nodded and swiveled back to the office. Sing turned toward Tong Tai.
"Tong Tai, find the dump site location and the potential primary crime scene."
"All right."
Paya rushed back to the room but could not find anyone, so he took out the phone to call Tarn, as per his usual habit. The tall figure emerged from the building, looking over and finding Tarn had already driven off, and Yai's car was about to accelerate away. When Yai's car was about to leave the DSI office, Paya jumped on his track. Once Yai's vehicle stopped, Paya yanked the door open in his hurry to get inside.
"Holy shit! What the fuck did you get in my way for? I almost hit you, bastard!"
Paya ignored those swear words and questioned Yai instead.
"Why didn't Tarn pick up the phone?"
"I don't know. He suddenly darted off and drove away,"
Yai said with a stern voice. Kim said to Paya, "Tarn said the crime scene was about to be burned down. Then he took the car and just drove away." Paya paused, thinking of Ajima's command, and nodded to Kim.
"Captain said that too."
Kim flinched. "How did Tarn know that the crime scene was about to be burned down? Wait, and did he know where the crime scene is?" Yai and Paya knew all too well how Tarn knew. Both men exchanged their gaze via the mirror reflection, but no one clarified Kim. Yai drove to follow Tarn's car in close proximity until they reached a house resembling a farmhouse. The floating gray smoke contrasted with the color of the sky. Tarn pulled up, burst out of the car, and advanced toward the cloud of smoke. Paya watched Tarn from behind in worry. As soon as Yai's car stopped, Haya leaped out of the car and chased after Tarn. Today was genuinely his marathon day, Tarn thought as he ran through the smoke to the backyard and found 5 to 6 elementary school kids helping one another to burn the house. He discreetly sneaked and grabbed the torch from those children's hands, causing them to flinch simultaneously. Haya, who was running after his buddy, saw Tarn had already snatched the torch from those kids, but the fire was still burning the old, shabby farmhouse down to the ground. Haya looked for the water source to stop the fire and stumbled upon a water tap nearby, along with a small, leaking bucket. He filled up the water and used it to extinguish the fire. Tarn gasped for air, looking at the kids one by one, then threw the torch onto the ground and kicked the dirt to put out the fire. These kids, boys and girls, nervously stared at him as they huddled together. Seeing their demeanor, the slim figure adopted a smiling face.
"Come on, kids. This brother is a cop, coming to save you."
Those kids still stood motionless, and the girls started to cry. Tarn's face went pale, so he slowly approached them and lowered himself.
"Don't be scared. I'm here to save you."
"You didn't come to catch us, right?"
a boy voiced up to ask. Tarn nodded off as he reached out to hold them in his arms.
"Don't worry. I'm not here to catch you, really."
"But we burned the house,"
one of the kids protested.
"Are you really not going to catch us? Really?"
Tarn shook his head. A girl lifted her gaze up, looking at him in tears.
"But we can complete the mission. It means we can save Nongpa. Nongpa will die."
"Nongpa? Is there one more kid?"
"Where is Nongpa, though?"
Tarn asked patiently. His heart instantly pounded hard at the girl's words that another kid was in the house. Or is the kid in this burning house?
"In the house next door. That brother told us that if we could complete the mission on time, that the hour hand pointed to this number, the minute hand pointed to this number, he would release Nongpa."
One of those girls explained. Tarn examined them. They might be roughly 5 or 6 years old. "The house next door?" Tarn turned toward the house next to him and let out a sigh of relief, only praying that the kid would be all right.
"Right. We were playing a game called The Hero. It was so much fun. The last stations to save Nongpa."
Another kid told him.
"How many days have you been playing this game?"
"We just started today, in this morning."
Tarn peeked at his watch. It was 6 o'clock. How was that kid now?
"Today's mission is complete. Everybody did a good job. I'll bring Nongpa out for you all,"
Tarn told them. Once he finished his sentence, those kids lifted their hands and laughed with joy.
"Yay! We did it!"
Tarn curled up a thin smile. He looked at these kids and felt his anger skyrocket at what Narong used these children to do. Hero? More likely he fooled them to burn the crime scene and destroy the evidence. If he had been here a little later, how would these children be? Would they doubt their actions or whether what they had committed was wrong? This would taint them and leave them guilty for the rest of their lives. That son of a bitch. Is there any humanness remaining in him?
Whoosh!
"Thank you for saving them." Tarn closed his eyes, calmed himself down. He curved his lips upward once he heard those soft, grateful words beside his ear. But that ringing sound in his head, he understood just now that the ones who needed to be saved were these children. It was to save them, not him. Save them from unintentional crime, to protect these children. Yai and Kem rushed toward Tarn and the kids,
sweeping around, and saw Paya was trying to snuff out the fire alone, so they joined him. Soon enough came the siren sound from the fire truck to help them subdue the fire before it spread.
Kim, take care of the children for me.
Where are you going, Tarn?
There's another kid in the house. I'll take him out,
said Tarn before darting into the house beside the former one. However, the door was locked by a big padlock and chain. Tarn picked up the gun, shut the chain, shattering, and yanked the door in. He saw a kid sleeping on the couch with a blanket covering his body and the motor fan turned on to cool him. Looking at the table, Tarn saw snacks, crumbs, and the milk carton piled up. So Tarn reached out for the boy, checking his pulse and breath. He was still breathing. Tarn exhaled a sigh in relief and tried nudging him awake, but the boy didn't wake up. Or was he drugged? It was plausible, assuming from those gnats that he had eaten. Tarn nestled the little boy up to his chest, took him to the ambulance, and placed him onto the stretcher. Then told the boy's condition in brief to the paramedics.
He was probably drugged by the sedative.
All right.
The nurse nodded in acknowledgement and brought the boy in for a checkup. Shortly after, the whining from the crowd erupted. Those kids' parents made their way to pull their little boys and girls into their embrace and ask them tirelessly whether they were all right. Tarn withdrew himself to stand next to Kim, watching the firefighters seizing the fire alongside Yai and Paya.
Tarn, how did you know the crime scene is here?
Kim pivoted to ask out of curiosity. Tarn slipped out a nervous expression.
I presumed.
A lame excuse was given.
Presumed? Yeah, because this famous farmhouse belongs to Vid. Other than Narong's house, here is another suspicious place.
Tarn reasoned nonsensically. Kem's curiosity still lingered.
But we'd better hurry to the department. Captain Gold is back.
Yai interrupted before looping his arm around Kem's neck and taking him away. Tarn sighed in relief, glanced at Paya and was on the verge of speaking, but Paya wheeled away, leaving Tarn stranded with mouth hanging agape. Tarn could only watch Paya's back until Paya ascended into the car and drove away with P.I.
Shit, what's wrong with you? Why don't you just say what makes you mad at me?
Tarn kicked the soil to vent before hopping in the car and handed his responsibility to the officers in crime scene, investigation, and forensic division to take further action. Interrogation room, DSI office. Silence took over when Singh told Narong that Songyo's corpse in Vit's backyard hadn't been burned along with that wooden farmhouse as Narong had planned. Furthermore, Vit had already confessed to the police about assisting Narong in the torture of the victims from the beginning to the very end of the process. From the indifferent expression and the triumphant, sparkling eyes, now they were clouded. Those black orbs, with a lack of gleam, gradually turned into bloodshot red, washing away the white of his eye. Those round, hollowed eyes frequently blinked, propelling the tears to cascade down from those pupils.
What about my sister?
His sister, who should have witnessed that man's death and suffering, but everything was ruined because of this goddamn department. Narong clenched his fist until his hands quaked and pursed his lips tight, overwhelmed with fury as he looked at Singh. Singh said nothing. He only observed Narong quietly.
She should have seen him die in torment. But you, all of you, destroyed everything I had planned.
Narong burst out his anger harshly, rose from his chair and tried to jump over Singh. But before his cuffed hands could blow onto Singh, the officers sitting on the opposite side pressed him down, holding him still by the shoulder to sit back on the chair.
All of you have no idea. No idea how I've been waiting for this moment. And what that son of a bitch did to my sister? Did you ever know that? You all know nothing. You all know nothing!
Nerong laughed in tears. His vacant eyes drifted upward to the white fluorescent light. The memories of good old days, so recent like fresh paint, swept across his mind.
Bro, you'll be surprised on my commencement ceremony day.
His sister drew close and encircled his arm. Her crystal clear voice kept boasting about her graduation.
What surprise, there? Wait until you get a job and brag.
Nerong pushed her in the head with force before getting inside the house and turned a deaf ear to the big brag girl of their family.
Gee!
Rin pouted, forming a sulky face behind her brother's back. She sat under the table under the tree, tapped for a job on the internet, and sent the email for her application. 3 days later, the company made an appointment for her job interview. She rushed to declare it to her brother, who was preparing food in the kitchen.
Bro, the company appointed me for a job interview.
Really?
Really, I'm not lying. Look here.
She handed her phone to her brother to read the email. Nerong unveiled a broad smile. He gently stroked his sister's head and praised her.
Well done.
Because I'm your sister, we only have each other. I will never let you down.
Rin leaned down to hug her older brother. Nerong curled up a big smile and kissed her head. Nerong lowered his gaze to his sister's confirmation email for a job interview again. That was a big company too. Great job, my naughty girl. He thought everything would have worked out well at the time, so that he and his sister would have started their life anew after years of struggling. And when Rin could take care of herself, he would rest easy and pay his full attention to his work without worry. However, fate was too cruel, and because of him, who couldn't pick her up that day, Rin was perpetrated by Songyos, that monster. He, who was going home to see his sister and looking forward to the good news about her job interview, ended up visiting the crime scene after receiving a call that they found a woman lying naked in the dense grass. Who would ever imagine that when he was out to collect the biological trace evidence, it would be the semen strain that the motherfucker left on his sister's body. He received the call from Vit that Rin was in the hospital, so Nerong hastily drove his car to see her. Once he realized what she had gone through, Nerong collapsed with his heart shattered in pieces. From that day, Rin was eternally transformed into a completely different person.
I cried for your help that day, but you didn't come. You promised that whenever I called for your help, you'd be there for me. You told me you'd be my hero to save me, but why weren't you there?
Because of him, who didn't pick her up as he kept putting his mind onto his work, leading his sister to meet such a circumstance. Because of him, who couldn't keep his promise. After Songyos was prosecuted, Rin remained moped and pensive. She refused to talk to anyone and didn't allow any other man but him to come within her reach. Her condition ached his heart. Even worse, he needed to inform her advisor that he needed to call off his sister's commencement ceremony. How sad. She should have come as she was the first class honor student. But that's all right. I understand it. I wish her to get well soon. Nerong squeezed the phone in his hand tightly. He hung up with his sister's advisor and approached to pull his poor girl into his embrace, crying. She was supposed to have a good life. Why? Why did she have to meet a misfortune like this? Ever since his sister fell ill, Nerong had been taking care of her closely, hoping she would return to her normality soon. However, his hope couldn't be fulfilled.
as his sister could no longer tolerate this disgrace. She took advantage of the time he was out working and ended her own life. Even the home care nurse couldn't stop her because she had locked the door. By the time the nurse called for help, it was already too late. He lost his sister, his one and only, the last remaining member of his family, forever. After the loss of her, Norong determined to put that scumbag to face the consequences behind bars for the rest of his life. On the day the court imprisoned Song Yeos, Narong tried to pull strings and called in favors from his boss to ensure Song Yeos received a life sentence. In truth, Narong wanted to demand this beast's execution, but he was well aware that it would be difficult. So, he settled for wanting Song Yeos to be locked away in jail for life. Unfortunately, legally it couldn't be committed. And the court only sentenced him to 10 years in prison. Just 10 years. Narong, who had always had faith in the law, was shaken to the core as soon as he realized he couldn't do anything more than this. Despite his firm protests that someone like Song Yeos would harm many lives if he was released, no one agreed with Narong's idea. With the millions of good deeds he had done, he only wished to be reimbursed just once with his plea. Yet, it wasn't worth enough for anybody to listen, not in comparison to the millions of misdeeds, but still received the opportunity to justify. Why? Why, at the very second that he longed to save his sister, everyone took his wish for granted. The idea that was the only action that could be done for his sister, but in the end, he couldn't make it. Narong took a deep breath, lifted his arm to wipe out the tears, and unveiled a grin. Since everything has gone this far, then I'll make my confession. I forced Bit to help me. He wasn't willing to do it. He's already told us, because he took his brother hostage. That was Nong Pa, Tarn's rescued kid. By the time Narong began his ruthless kills, he had asked Vit to stay at Vit's apartment, and then Narong had used Nong Pa as a bargaining threat because he and Nong Pa were so close and Nong Pa was attached to him. Vit couldn't do anything to Narong due to the fear that Nong Pa would find out.
He would hate me for life.
Because Narong chose to walk this path and let the only beautiful thing he had slip through his fingers.
For this matter, you need to talk to him in person.
However, Vit's demeanor didn't show his hatred toward Narong in the slightest, contrary to what Narong had assumed. Instead, Vit was likely to be sad and regret that Narong chose to go down this road. They looked as if they were bound by some special feelings. Nonetheless, Singh wasn't the one who would bring this matter up to comfort the criminal. He would want the criminal to realize it by himself. Or maybe, Narong might have already known it from the start.
Detective, you think to work in this occupation makes you a hero?
Singh seized in his tracks, the hand reaching out to the doorknob, held onto it but didn't twist it open.
You may not see it yourself that way, but during a hard time, this is how citizens out there think of you. You're not going to ruin the citizen's hope, right?
Just like what he had experienced, just like how his hope was ruined. After digging into the truth behind Song Yeos's early release, he discovered that he had his connections, and so did Song Yeos. Singh didn't respond. He just walked out of the interrogation room and lifted his hand to touch his own temples. Seconds later, Captain Ojima led the DSI team out from the room next door. They traded their gaze with the weight of their hearts. No one uttered a word, knowing all too well why Song Yeos received a sentence reduction. This topic had always been a hot-button issue. The more they talked about it, the more wrong they were to themselves. So everyone left it unsaid, packed up their belongings, and went their separate ways to rest. But instead of Tarn going out to the parking lot in front of the building, he made his way back to the holding cell. Kaya saw Tarn from the rear go in that direction. He tried to sneak out without making the other person realize his presence. Tarn stopped at Narong's cell and greeted him. "Hi." Narong lifted his gaze to meet Tarn, then lowered it back to the floor, ignoring him. Tarn pursed his lips and released. "The question that you asked in the interrogation room, I have the answer for you. Do you want to hear that?" Narong didn't answer. Instead, he lay down on the mattress, turning his back to Tarn, but Tarn didn't care. He only wanted Narong to acknowledge it. "You say that we are the citizens' hope. It's probably true, but we think of ourselves as just a tiny hope in a part of their lives. If the hope has been ruined at some time in their life, we just wish they could form up a new hope and keep moving on." The finger that was tapping on the mattress paused. "I believe that your sister wished that too." Despite the grudge that Narong had used many people for his own crime, the wish of that woman couldn't be ignored either. "Her time is up, but for you, you're still alive and deserve a good life. The one that you've remained, Viv and his brother, she wants you to preserve them well."
"You talk like..."
But Tarn had a conversation with his sister before. "She also said that her first class honor, she did it for you. She wanted to make you happy for the thing that happened that day. It wasn't your fault. To her, you've always been her hero, ever the same." Kaya, who overheard what Tarn was saying, unfurled a faint smile. He journeyed to his car before Tarn would know he was still there. Tarn, on the other hand, breathed out a sigh after he finished speaking, then swiveled his heels away. He asked if the voice in his head was already satisfied with his action, and he only received a soft breeze in his ear before it faded away. Narong arrested in his motion and slowly turned towards Tarn, but Tarn had already left. He stood up, holding the bars, and was poised to call out for Tarn. However, he chose to suppress it. He wanted to know how Tarn knew about his sister's first-class honor. But after remembering that the other person was a police officer and might somehow have looked over his sister's profile, his doubts soon subsided. He lay down on the bed and decided to move on. Since he chose to walk down this path, how could he manage to move on anyway? Despite that thought, he still felt grateful to that police officer in the back of his mind. Thank him for answering his question. Amolvipak's house. Kaya drove back home, so full of fatigue that his eyes were about to close. He chased after the bad guy and extinguished the fire all day, but his own fatigue might be less than the other person's. As Paya thought of him, Tarn's face cast right to his mind. He tried to shake that smiling face of the person away and hurried along the spiral staircase to his room, ran his errand, took a shower, and threw himself onto the bed instantly. It was such a tiring day. Let him rest.
"Master Paya! Master Paya! Master Paya!"
"Who is calling me? I'm sleeping. Can't you see?"
"I can."
That voice answered him back too.
"I am in your thoughts. How could I not know what you are thinking?"
Kaya furrowed his brows and opened his eyes. Once he saw a woman sitting on his bed, he was startled and sprang up into a sitting position.
"You!"
"Who?" "Oh, right.
Vanvisa."
"It's me."
She smiled at him before presenting herself for him to take a look. Now, She was adorned in human clothes.
Miss, why are you here?
Maya stuttered his question as he never thought of seeing her in such an attire. Couldn't deny that she was exotically pretty in it. No, this wasn't the right time to fantasize about her, Maya. When Visa curled her lips upward at Maya's thought, feigning a cough, saying,
"Surely, I've come to see you. That's why I'm here. However, did you forget what I promised you?"
Maya adopted a thoughtful expression. When Visa let loose a sigh of disdain, humans can forget things so easily. Well, if she kept wasting her breath, they would have come nowhere. Her time was running out.
"Please, come, follow me. I'll walk you through your past life memories."
Past life mem...
Not waiting for Paya to end his sentence, Van Visa stretched out her finger and tapped it in the middle of Paya's forehead. Paya remained unmoved while Van Visa closed her eyes, sinking into her meditative state. No matter what it took her, she must complete it in no time. Because he started to realize that she had sneaked out to meet up with Paya. End of chapter 11.